talk about our frontend workflow. And let me first introduce myself. I'm Siddharth. You might know me from Twitter at SiddharthKB. If you don't, then you should follow me. I post all sort of like garbage stuff. But I do a bunch of open source. So if you're using any of my open source stuff, come say hi. I get super excited. And I also do these YouTube things where I try to teach what I've learned. So if you want to look at really short videos of nice snippets, then you can go to this thing. Alright. And well, this is wrong. Lastly, I do this new thing which is called Frontend Army. It's like a workshop series thing. So if your team does React stuff and you're looking for senior developers to help you out, get in touch. It's like a mentor for hire kind of thing. Go to frontend.army. There's my email address. Let's get in touch. Cool. I work at this company, Odd0. They make authentication stuff, la la la. Nobody cares. The part we do care about is we use React, and we use a lot of React. So that's that. And I want to talk about our frontend workflow, and which is basically broken. And I say this in context of Odd0, but I think you will find this talk related. A lot of problems that we have are kind of common problems. Alright. Let me try to first back this up. Why do I say our frontend is broken? So the first symptom that our frontend is broken is the quality. So to give you an example, the top thing is what the designer designed, and the bottom thing is what the developer built. Right? So it looks kind of the same, but you see the designer has this like cute blue icons, they sit inside the input box, and the developers are like, ah, negative margin, I don't want to do that. So you just put it outside with an ugly gray border. The other thing is that your designer comes up with this like nice mockup with like animation on over, right? And the response they usually get is, ain't nobody got time for that, right? Deadline, I have product managers, and there's this GraphQL thing that everyone keeps talking about, so I have other things to do. I'm not going to spend time on your shaky mockups. The second symptom that your frontend is broken is consistency. Right? And this is something which is kind of very dear to me. So we have multiple products, and inside every product we have this thingy that's on the top right, right? You have your name, you click, and it's a drop down, and the things come in. So these are three of them across different. They kind of look the same, but they're not really like they have the same shadow and everything, but they're slightly different, right? So for example, in the first one, your view profile thing is on the bottom, and there's like a flag thing on the top, it's like a region switcher. On the second one, I don't know what clicking on my name will do. Maybe it will go to profile, maybe it will not. I really like the third one. It's just like log out, like get out. Right? That's all. But these are like things that your users have to learn, and it's like inconsistent and it's difficult for them to keep track. And this is like a very old joke, which is like every designer has 50 shades of gray inside their sketch pad. Alright. So all of these are symptoms. They're not necessarily the problems. They're symptoms of the problem. And the real problem lies in communication. So this is the communication between designers and developers and like the collaboration part. And all of this rises from this one common concept of handoff. Right? So there's a wretched concept called handoff. How many of you are familiar with handoffs? Right? You do handoffs in your company, right? Just two people. Okay, so let me try to explain what handoffs are. Your designer gets like a requirement kind of thing, and then he goes into a cave for 5 weeks, and he comes back with these fancy designs, and then he's like, this is what we're going to make, right? And then the developers kind of look at that design, and then they take 5 weeks and go into a cave, and then come back with like, this is the product. And then the QA does the same, right? Does that sound familiar? Right? So this is kind of the example of what your designer comes back with, right? He's like nicely designed screens, with like delayed on perfectly, they use nice purple colors, so that's what's trending right now. And the developers are looking at it like, hey, what is this hex code? What color is this? Is this accessible? And how many pixels is this? And like which screen comes after which screen? Like this looks pretty, but what do I do? So that's, and of course, like I have to admit that our tools have come a long way, right? Like there's tools like Zeppelin, which like developers can like hover over it and tell you this button is 14 pixels by 12 pixels, and sometimes also you copy the CSS. This thing like envision where you can comment on things and say, this is crap, please change this, and then like, have collaboration. But these tools still revolve around the same idea of handoff. Right? it's still revolving around the same thing. And so if I enough complaining, what's the solution? So Twitter tried to come up with a solution in 2011 with Bootstrap, right? And they basically made every website in the world look the same. So like any self-respecting front-end team, we try to create a Bootstrap of our own, right? That's what you do. So we have these, all of these buttons and all of these like states of the buttons. You have different states for different colors. You have icons and you have, I don't know, you have a bunch of things. And this is kind of what it looks like, right? You have an icon and a text. This is how you get it out. You go to the documentation, you copy the class. You say this is a button default. I'm using an icon, which for some reason is italics, even though it's not like the correct tag, but I think it's II, so we could use it. Anyway, so you put an icon, you say I want button icon, and this is the icon I want, icon package. And then I say success with thing. Now, your designers do a user research, right? Which is codenamed for the last 5 people, and all of them agreed. And they said, we're going to move icons to the right now, because that's more accessible, or that converts more or something. So, and then they said, this is what we should do. So they changed the style, they changed the CSS. But that doesn't really solve the problem, because everywhere you use this icon, you also have to go and switch this, right? The icon cannot be first. You have to change it, and the icon has to come second, and the success, the text has to come first, right? So it kind of, like, it's very close to what it wanted to be, but it doesn't really do the job. So this is what's known as a leaky abstraction, right? Like, it tries to abstract all of the design details, but it does a very bad job, and most of the implementation details still leak out to the user. Surprise, surprise, React components are the right abstraction, right? So React components, so React culture, what do you expect? React components. And so, instead of this, you can say things like this. You can say, import a button from the library, and then you say button icon package, and after this, then they ask 5 people and to change it, you don't really have to care, because your implementation detail doesn't really, sorry, your usage of this thing doesn't really know about the implementation detail, right? This is not a leaky abstraction. So React components are the right abstraction for design in depth. And this has given rise to this fancy new thing called design systems, which has been talked about enough, so I'm not going to explain what it is. But other than this one definition that I really like, so this is Harry Sanderman, who works on daily design system thing in Airbnb. And he said design systems are a set of shared and integrated principles and patterns that define the overall design of the product. The keywords here are overall design of the product. So when you look at Airbnb's logo, you know it's Airbnb. They have like a certain style to it. When you see a Facebook like button on the wall, you know it's Facebook. So you don't have to write Facebook under it, right? It's the design and the tone kind of speaks for that. And so it has all of these things that Tejas already talked about. And don't get me wrong, components are still a part of it, right? That's the kind of part that I want to focus on. So let's get into the technical stuff. So to build a design system, you need these ingredients. First of all, you need tokens, right? Tokens are a fancy designer way of saying variables. So this is kind of how you can use variables in the proper way. Say you have spacing, right? So instead of using any bit of value of spacing you want, it's a good idea to kind of lay them out into multiples of a unit. So for example, over here, what we use is unit is 8, and then you have extra small, which is 2, which is like 8 pixels, and then small is 16 pixels, and then I ran out of names, so I said extra large is 8 into 7. The names matter less over here, what matters more is the common language. So when you ask your designer what should be the margin, you're not saying 32 pixels, right? You're not saying 17 pixels margin. You're saying, let's use medium spacing over here. That's what we use for all section margins, right? And that's like an easy way of communicating. The other thing that also, or actually, let me say that, right? You can do the same with color, right? So you start with a base color, for example, let's talk about gray. You have one gray color, and then you have 5 shades over here. You can have multiple shades. Atlassian's design system uses 16 shades for the Atlassian. But we kind of found that 5 shades are more than enough for us. So we do this with every color. We say, this is the base color, this is the dark color. And you see, these are classed objects. So now, again, when you say, what should be the color of the button, you're not saying, let's use sky blue, let's use turquoise green. You're saying, let's use blue light, let's use light blue. Right? And then you don't have to look at the sky to know what light blue is. You just say colors.blue.light, and it means the same thing for everyone. You're not talking hex codes, you're not talking pixels, you're talking variables, right? So so the conversation is easy. And the other part, which is like a hidden point but I really like, is that it steals the creativity from your designer a little bit, right? They can't start from a blank canvas, they start with this palette and they can only choose the right colors from there. So that kind of limits your design, it just makes it consistent. The next part is you can also bake in brand guidelines. So for example, over here we have some dimensions, like success. If you use the success button, the background is colors.green.light and the foreground, the text on it is supposed to be colors.white. Right? Same thing goes with like, you have a destructive button, like a delete button, the background is colors.red.base and the foreground is colors.light. Right? So here again, now what you're doing is you're creating another level of abstraction where you say, I have a delete button, what color should I use? You say, I'm going to use the destructive color and you get a set of colors to use. Right? So again, you're not even talking which shade of red, darker, extra dark. You're just saying, I'm going to use the destructive button because that's what it's for. Good. So, the good part about this, like creating them as JavaScript objects, is that you can directly use them in React. Right? So, this is like the full CSS in JS shape. Please don't kill me. I like CSS as well, it's nice. But what we also do with this is, you can use it in Angular projects for this is JavaScript. We also export them as SAS variables and XML files for our Angular code. So you can actually just take this and export it for everyone so that even if you're not using React components in your native Android code, at least you're using the same color, the same guidelines. So that's enough to create consistency. The next part of this is like the big part, which is component library. So, and this is like a long code by a really smart guy, the important part here is when you're creating components for a design system, it's important to prioritize API stability over any specific implementation detail. So, like the layman translation for this is, it should look good when people use it. Internally, you can do whatever you want, right? So, and this is kind of what we spend a lot of time. So, for example, this is our API. If you want an icon, you say icon. The icon name is analytics, and the size is 20, right? Then you say button. I want a primary button with an icon of copy. So this is kind of aimed at when you talk, when you like design and review, can we add a button here? The conversation is like, can we have a primary button here with a copy icon? And this is kind of what you're also typing in English, right? So the more your code looks like the conversation that you have, the easier your API is, the more intuitive it's going to be. Similarly, switches, what do switches do? They toggle, right? This could have on change, on press, etc. But because you have to support multiple devices, the common noun is toggle. You say on toggle and then you can pass the function. Cool. A couple of React patterns really come in handy over here, like compound components. So compound components are this concept where you can nest components inside a parent component. So because React components are JavaScript objects, you can actually just attach things inside. For example, when you create tabs, you can say the parent is tabs, and then inside it you can say tabs.tab. The syntax looks a little weird, but the good part of this is you only import tab once. You don't have to say import tab and tab, the small tab. Similarly, if you're creating a form, you don't have to say import form, text import text to your action. You just import form, and then rest of the things come as children. The other abstraction hidden over here is when you say form.textInput, you're not actually just getting a text input. You're getting a wrapper around a text input, and then we also pass label, which is aligned nicely. I'll come to the examples for this. But this is kind of how the API looks and it's like our attempt at making it easy to use. So the core idea is the API should look nice to use, it should be intuitive. Internally, you can do whatever you want. Documentation. This is like my favorite topic. How many people dare to write documentation for their code? Just like a wave. Wow, that's more than I expected. Good, good job, guys. The fun part about creating your own design system is documentation is the problem, right? Like if I create a button and don't document it, you can't search on Stack Overflow and find that I wrote this. If I don't document it, it literally doesn't exist for me, right? So documentation is the most core part. If it's not documented, it might as well not exist. So these are like nice tools, Storybook and Style Guides, which do a really good job at getting you started. Storybook is more like isolated components. React Style Guides is more aimed towards creating a list library of components. We ended up creating a custom mesh of this thing. I'll show that. Yeah, so we call our design system Cosmos. I forgot why this slide is here. As I click, I just go. The next cool part is that design decisions are baked into the system. Right? And now I'm regretting putting this cupcake in my slide because it's very interesting. Anyway, so here's an example. When you say you want a page header, you're not saying I want an H1, H2, you don't really care. You say I want a page header. And the design detail that this is the size, this is the accessible HTML tag is baked in. Right? That's what React makes you do. When you say actions, these are the actions that my header has. You say this is my primary action, this is my secondary action. Now, what's the color of the primary versus the secondary? You don't care. That's baked into the system. Are they left aligned? Are they right aligned? Does the primary come left? Secondary come left? You don't care. The designers have spent their time doing user research, asking 5 people, and they have baked these systems. They make these decisions. The good part is when these decisions change, you don't really have to care because they change internally. Like it's in the implementation detail, not in the API. Form is kind of my favorite. I spent a lot of time building this. So here's like a form which has 3 fields and then it has a primary action. And let me just try to show like the code part of it, how does this work. This is like my sample page, this is kind of empty right now, and I'm just going to copy and paste the same code that's on the slide. And let me just try to go through it. So you have a form, and then you have a form.text input, which has a type, label, your text area, your switch, which only has a label, and then you have action, where primary action is this. You have to give your own handle, which you can write over here. Now I save this, hopefully it works. So these are the nice things that happen. The label is left aligned and it's aligned like this. Right? This is not something you have to care about. All of these are aligned. These are design decisions now. The label could be left aligned, right aligned. These are things that your designers care about. You don't care about, you shouldn't have to care about. So let them do the work. The switch is all fancy, it lags and does all those nice things. It has an accessibility thing baked in. This is a feature that I really like. Can anyone tell me if I click on the input, obviously it focuses on the input, but what happens when I click on name? And what should happen? It should focus, right? But unless you write code for it, it never does, right? And no matter how much code I write in my life, I always forget that. The HTML for me. But the good part is now it's baked in the system, right? So all of these accessibility things are already baked into the system and designers don't have to care about it. Everything they build is already accessible to a certain extent. Same thing goes for the button, it's aligned with these input things and not the left things. All of this is things that I honestly don't care about. I just care about the, I want a form, this is the user input I want, and this is the logic part that I want. Another nice thing about this is, let me quickly jump to the docs. So for example, we have this component over here, and it comes with this by default label on the left layer. Now we have a product which is going responsive, which means you can't really do labels on the left because you don't have space, so labels need to go on the top. And for that, we essentially create a prop, and you say label on top, and the label changes. I can copy this from the docs and paste it in my code, and this thing should change to top, right? So these are the kind of things that you can bake in because these are design decisions that are abstracted. And the funny thing is, as long as you create an extra prop, it's not backward breaking and nobody does. That's it. The second last thing I'm going to talk about is your design assets should be synced to your components, like your actual code. So I think Peter's already said this, like when a designer wants to start something, he creates it, he goes to the sketch file, it says Ctrl C, Ctrl V, edits the new file, and then the new file is what you have, right? And God forbid if you know it's not going through the whole design, development, testing process, the design assets are not even the same. So first the designer has to sit and like sketch the whole thing again to make it similar. It's just time wasted. So the idea here is that people have already created nice tools like Airbnb, we have react-sketchapp, Brain, we have html-sketchapp. This one is good for native, that one is more, like plays nicer with web stuff. And yeah, the only thing to care about is components are symbols in sketch. So when you say, I want a button from the box, that is what the designer is also saying, and Sketch has libraries, so they basically do something like insert from Cosmos library button, right? right? And that's kind of what the developer is also doing, is it import button from Cosmos. So that kind of creates a parallel language. Props and overrides are also the same thing, and then as long as the source of truth is the code and you're generating sketch files from it, you make sure that things are always in sync. And when a designer wants to start a new project, they basically just update their sketch library and they're good to go. Alright, pro tips, things that I've learned for working on this project in 6 months. First of all, always stretch for consistency over flexibility. So for us, it's like very easy to just add a new prop, add an if condition and run away with it. But it's really useful to ask, do we really need this extra, variation of the same component? And the thing is, this is a question that is like very difficult to ask, but most of the time the variation exists not because it was needed at the time, it exists because nobody documented the original thing. So people did not know that this thing exists, so they created a new one, now you just have two. Right? This is kind of how most projects go. So always try to go for consistency. The second is build abstractions but ship all the building blocks. So I showed you page header, I showed you form and how they lay out things on their own. Now, a use case that came recently was people wanted like a bigger, scarier form. They wanted like a delete button and then they wanted like a big red border around it. And when you click on delete, it should say, are you sure you want to delete it? And then you say, okay, fine. So that's the kind of thing that they want, and our form doesn't support it. So it's a very custom, weird case. So you also don't want to become the, the roadblock. When you have multiple teams that rely on a system, it's very easy for a team to say, this is not in the system, so we'll block. We'll wait until the team builds it. So the idea is you build all the abstractions, but you also ship all the building blocks that they can use the form label, they can use the text input, they can use the border color from our dimensions, not destructive, and then make their own thing. And the good part is, if they make it, you can always bring it back into the system and promote it as a library component. Third thing is, adoption is the only metric that matters. So you can create all the fancy components that you want, but if it's not good to use, if it doesn't work out for your developers, then you're just building things for yourself. Like, there's no nerd pride in building things that nobody uses. So optimize for usage, optimize for what your actual use cases are, where your developers are. Interesting example I have here is, I really wanted to use portals, but I think they're really cool, so I went ahead and used portals from React 16, but turned out the app that I wanted to adopt the system was in React 15. Right? So I could have said, no, React 15 is old, React 16 is the new hot shit, so you should upgrade first, but that's just adding more hurdles to the users, right? So what we did is, these portals use like a polyfill, which adds a little bit to the size, but they could use it in the React 15 system. Adoption, optimize for adoption, not for code, beauty, and all of those. So the last thing I want to talk about is that I hope that folks are convinced that design systems are cool, you should use them, blah blah. How do you convince your company that this is something worth spending time on? Like, how do you go on Monday to your boss and say, you need to do design systems? This slide can also be renamed to people ruin everything, right? And the suits in this slide are empty. So the first thing you need to do is show people what's wrong. So when you talk about design system, you say you can create design systems and they're reusable and etc. But most people don't really have that, like, unless they're working on the same thing every day, like developers have to do, they might not have that visibility of what's broken, right? So for example, a product manager was really happy with the product until we showed that three different drop-down thingies and showed these are all different. Is this what you want? Is this what is good? And then it's like, yeah, this is not good. We should fix this, right? And then they show destructive buttons and say, this is red, this is pink, is that what you want? And you're like, yeah, this looks bad, when did we break this? So people might not know what's wrong unless you actually do this. So what my manager, who turns out to be a designer, actually did was, he went through each and every app that we had and documented, like created an inventory of things that we did by creating screenshots and then presented it and said, this is our current state. And everyone was like, oh, we thought we were a design focused company. Apparently we're not, so let's fix it. Show people what's wrong. Speak their language, right? If you go to the CEO and say reusability is cool and then we don't have to do this and you can only pass a prop and then abstraction, he's gonna say cool, sounds nice, but can you ship this feature rapidly? Right? That's what it's optimized for. So yeah, you need to speak their language, right? So when you talk to business folks, they say things like, in frontend, most of the developers spend 40% time creating presentational components and 60% time creating logic. This 40% time everyone does it, it's repeatable. We can actually just put like a 3-member team that does the 40 and then everyone else doesn't have to, right? Now this can make you think. One is that 40% of the team gets fired, right? And they save money. What luckily happened in our case is those 40% people got pulled into a different team and we started a new product, right? Either way, business thinks about money, right? So if you go to business folks or product managers, like CEOs, and you say reusability and nerd stuff and JavaScript and React, they don't really care, right? So drop their language and then you have their intent. The third thing is build support from developers. So before you do any of these two things, go to your fellow developers and talk to them about reusability and React and all of that shit, right? They care about this stuff, they get excited about this. So you say, the easiest way of seeing this is say, Flipkart did this, but we haven't done this. And then people are like, hey, we're also, like, we also have good developers, like, Kunki Sari, Man Sari is a separate case, right? So then like, we all have this, like, ego thing, right? So you build support from developers, like, this is the new hot thing, this is the way we do it, let's use GraphQL and whatever. And you have this support from the development layer, and then when you start speaking to higher-ups, they go back to their team and, like, one day the engineering manager is like, these kids are talking about design systems, like, yeah, do we need this? I don't think there's a problem. And then all the developers go, yes, we need design system, we've been seeing it for so long. So then instantly it becomes like a you say a consensus thing, and then the management is like, oh, we probably missed this. This was there all along. That's the third point. And yeah, I guess that's all the points I have. Cool. So I'm Siddharth Kitty on Twitter, you should follow me for more React stuff. And this is the Cosmos repo, it's all open source. So you should look at the API, you shouldn't look at the code is shitty, but the API is really nice. So that's all I have. Alright, thank you.